Good morning.
Good morning to everybody. Welcome to City Light Church. Everybody that is here for service but has not made their way into the sanctuary here, please go ahead and do so as we're just about to get worship started. As always, we are incredibly thankful for everyone who has chosen to spend their Sunday morning here with us. We know that it takes a measure of sacrifice to do that. It's so cold, for one thing, and it was very warm in bed this morning, very warm in the house, and so we appreciate everybody who made that sacrifice to come out and be here with us. We appreciate everyone tuning in virtually as well. I'm going to open us up in prayer, and as I do every week towards the end of that prayer, I'm going to pause for a few moments of silence, and during that time of silence, we ask that everyone that is here with us, as well as everyone that's tuning in virtually, please join with us in silent prayer that God would be present in our service today and would be glorified by it. Let's pray. Father God, you are holy and mighty and wonderful. Thank you so much for this day. Thank you so much for this church, City Light Church. God, thank you so much for your capital C church throughout the past two millennia, God, and throughout the world. Thank you so much for our context where we can come here and worship you openly without any fear of real persecution, God. Help us not take that for granted. Help us remember that is not the norm throughout history. And even today, there are many, many Christians who do not have that opportunity, God. And I pray that that would ever be in our hearts. God, I pray for our service today. I pray for our worship team. I pray that you would move in their hearts and focus their hearts, that they would seek to glorify you in their worship, God. God, we know that no matter how excellently we may present our worship service, no matter how talented our team is, God, unless our hearts are set on your glory, it's meaningless, God. We may as well stay home. And so I pray that you would move in our worship. I pray for the man that will bring your word today, God. I pray that you would lay a sermon on his heart, and that he would be able to rest in the comfort of knowing that he has only to deliver the sermon you have given him. I pray we, the church, would have open ears and open hearts to receive it, God, and we would leave here changed by it. I pray that we would not view this service as just something routine, God, like getting up, brushing our teeth, driving to work, but I pray that you would move and make us cognizant of the supernatural realities taking place. God, I pray for your church the world over that's worshiping you today. I pray for our leadership that can't be here with us today, Pastor Brian, Pastor Corey. We pray for the sick, God, that you would heal them. And we just pray for the obvious brokenness throughout our country and throughout the world, God. We pray for the day that you would return and you would take away all brokenness, God. But we pray for your mercy in that regard. And now we'll have a few moments of silence. Thank you, God. Above all things, above all this, God, I pray that there would be someone tuning in virtually or someone present with us here that does not know you, God, and I pray that you would open their heart, God, you would move in their heart to come to know you, God, to come to accept the death of your son as the sacrifice of their sins, God, and their only hope for eternal life, so that when we're worshiping you in a million years, they can be there with us. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm Pastor Brian Crawford. I'm kidding. I'm not Pastor Brian Crawford. I think I could pull it off. Y'all tracking with that? Pastor Brian couldn't be here with us today, but he did send me some announcements. First of all, we've started back Mission Community meetings and family meals. We are doing a series on gospel fluency. It was really good this past week, and so we ask everyone that can, please join with us. That's at 6 o'clock on Wednesdays, and if you're able, we ask that everyone that attends bring $5 to drop in the offering box to help with that family meal, and if you do that, please be sure to put it in an envelope. And write the write on that envelope what it's for, so that the church is able to keep track of that. And also remember to sign up for the meal for headcount purposes. But as I mentioned earlier, if you forget to sign up, or if there's any issue with the $5, do not let that dissuade you from coming. Everyone, please come. And then also that here at the church at 5, we're going to do a study on Romans. So ask that and know that any kids can come. They don't have to be connected to the church. So please feel free to invite anybody you know, from 12 through college age. Welcome to come. And yeah, that's all the announcements that we had for today. So I think we will continue with our worship service, if y'all want to come back up. Thanks.
Praise God, everybody. All right, so as we continue worship, we ask that you stand and open your hearts. So this next song is Unstoppable God, and one of our other favorites, right? We sing it often. So join in, clap, and worship. Amen?
Amen.
All right.
Intro.
Shout your praise forevermore.
reached the part where it's time for our reading. Woo! I was excited to read the word of God. So this morning we are coming from Psalms 27, verses 1 through 14. And I do believe that everybody here has been here before. So I don't have to give you guys the whole spiel. So we're going to start at verse 1 with myself. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arises against me, yet I will be confident. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will lift me high upon a rock. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud, be gracious to me. And answer me.
You have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Lord, will I seek.
Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger. O, you who have been my help, cast me not off, forsake me not, O God of my salvation. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living altogether. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. These are God's words. All righty, guys, we're going to continue to worship the Lord God Almighty. We all know that Christ is our firm foundation. He is the solid rock on which we stand. So even though things may seem a little bit unsure sometime or whatever, be glad in Christ. Continue to stand on him. Continue to put your faith in him because he truly will never let you down.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand, and everything around me is shaken. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense. So I won't be gone. Let me down. He's faithful in every season.
Jesus. Thank you.
You ready?
Join me now in praying, family. Heavenly Father, we come to you in awe of your holiness and power and greatness, but confident in your grace and in your love for us because of what you've done for us in Jesus Christ. And we know that he's at your side advocating for us. We thank you so much, Jesus. Lord, we pray that you would refresh our hearts with the gospel today and daily. Lord, we pray that as your word says, the perfect love that you have for us would cast out fear, and that we would have love for you that is more and more pure and how it ought to be, Lord. We know that we fail and that we sin. Lord, give us repentant hearts and lead us to live in righteousness by your power and the Holy Spirit who lives within us. We pray, Lord, that you are bringing people to us that you have prepared to place their faith in Jesus. And we pray that that incredible transformation would begin today and would continue for all eternity, Lord, until we are perfected when we are in heaven with you. We thank you so much, God, that you give us this opportunity to hear your word. And we pray, Lord, that you would be with Pastor Scott this morning as he preaches to us. We pray that your Holy Spirit would work powerfully within him and that the words that he speaks to us that are in accordance with your holy word would go into our hearts. They would pierce us and give us conviction and comfort, that we would have increased knowledge, and that we would receive so much grace from you, Lord, to obey your word. We pray above all things that you would be glorified because you are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen.
You may be seated. I'm Pastor Corey D'Amport. So, I'm Scott Fortenberry. I had the privilege of being here over the last 6 months as a part of the My Boulevard cohort. I am one of the most recent graduates of the My Boulevard development series there in planting churches. I have known your pastor for quite some time. In fact, I was here on the launch 8 years ago, give or take. Is that about right? So, and I had the opportunity to preach here just a few weeks ago, 3 or 4 weeks ago. And so I'm excited to be back and to be here with you. And I am sorry for the circumstances. I hate that Pastor Corey is not feeling well, but I do appreciate the opportunity to be able to preach. When I was in high school, my junior year, I was playing baseball for a little bitty school. We had about 25 in my junior class. And the last 2 years, they had gone to the state championship, and they had been beaten by Deer Creek. And my junior year, we went down to Deer Creek, or up to Deer Creek up in the Delta, and they beat us. And so it's a 2 out of 3 series, and we had to come back. We didn't have a home field, and so we were playing at Mississippi College. We won game one, and as game two hit, we took the lead, and in the 7th inning, you could feel it. Everything in the room, you could feel that we were about to win the defending state champions who had won back-to-back state titles. We were leading. It was the 7th inning. There was one out in the bottom of the 7th, and all of a sudden, you start hearing. And then I was playing shortstop at the time, and you kind of looked around in the stands, and one by one, people started standing. And they would kind of join in the clap, and then there were two outs. And then they hit a ground ball to me, and I threw it to the first baseman. And before it hit the first baseman's glove, the whole place was just erupted. Everybody was on their feet, and everybody was standing. There are different moments in our life that make us do something different. Baseball is not a typically riveting sport that has fans standing on their feet. It's just not typically what happens in baseball. It's been labeled a whole bunch of things. But when something big is happening, our posture changes. Have y'all ever noticed that? We do something different. I'm about to read a whole bunch of scripture for me. They're not going to have it on the screen, and I don't expect them to, because I'm going to read it fast. But I want y'all to hear all this. Matthew 26:64. Yes, it is as you say, Jesus replied. But I say to you, in the future, you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on clouds of heaven. Mark 14:62, I am, Jesus said, and you'll see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds in heaven. Mark 16:19, after the Lord Jesus had spoken to them and was taken up into heaven, he sat at the right hand of God. Colossians 3:1, since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father. Y'all can help me with this, I would imagine. Hebrews 1:3, the Son is in the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. He had provided purifications for sin, and he sat down at the right hand of God in majesty. The point of what we're saying is this. We don't have such a high priest who sat down at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heaven. That was Hebrews 1:8. Hebrews 12:2. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Ephesians 1:20, which he exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms. Revelation 5:7. He came back and he took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. What is Jesus doing? He's sitting at the right hand of the Father. Why is Jesus sitting at the right hand of the Father? Well, one reason is he's in complete control. He is sitting at the right hand of the Father with everything under him, everything under his control. There is nothing that happens that he hasn't had his hand on. He has all authority. He has all of power. He has everything that he needs. Therefore, he can sit at the right hand of the Father knowing everything is under control. Doesn't that bring you great hope? Isn't that very relieving on days when your world falls apart? That Jesus is not up in arms. That he's not sitting there going, oh no, what are we going to do now? He is seated with boldness and with confidence, knowing exactly what happens. But there is one time in all of Scripture where Jesus does something different. If you have your Bible, turn with me to Acts chapter 7. Acts chapter 7. Acts chapter 7, starting in verse 54. That's a long chapter. Acts chapter 7, starting in verse 54, it says this. Now when they heard these things, they were enraged, and they ground their teeth at him. But he, full of the Holy Spirit, he gazed into heaven, and he saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father. And he said, behold, I see the heavens, and he opened, and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. But they cried out in a loud voice, and they stopped their ears, and they rushed together, and then they cast him out of the city, and they stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their garments at the feet of a young man named Saul. And as they were stoning Stephen, he cried out, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And falling to his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. In all of Scripture, we have all of these times where Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father, and all of a sudden we come here to this one moment, this one time, when Jesus is standing at the right hand of the Father. What is it about Stephen that makes Jesus do something different? What is it? I think it has to do with his life. I really do. I think Jesus is pulling for him. I think Jesus is encouraging him. Why Stephen could see into heaven at this moment, I think God parted whatever it is so that he could see Jesus. And I think Jesus is going, attaboy, I'm proud of you. You got this. Stand strong. I think all those things are true. But Stephen's not the only one that's going to get stoned to death. Stephen's not the only character that's going to be martyred for his faith. So there is more than just this moment. Something has led Jesus to respond differently to Stephen. If you have your Bible and you're at Acts 7:54, flip back two pages. I told you I'm reading a lot of scripture today. We're going to camp here for a little while. Acts chapter 6 is where we're actually first introduced to Stephen. We're going to look at the first 10 verses here, asking this question: what is so different about this Stephen that it makes Jesus do something different in heaven? And the challenge for us up front is, what is it about Stephen's life that can apply to our life that can make Jesus do something different in heaven? Is there stuff that we can do here that catches his eye? Let's look at what happened here in the life of Jesus, in the life of Stephen. Acts chapter 6. Now, in these days, when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint against the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. Let's just stop right there for just a moment. This idea of racial struggle did not start with us. It has been going on for all times. We have all these rubs of these people are better, these people get served more, these people, we have these issues that struggle with all of us. That's one of the beauties that we have in churches like this, in churches like Soul City, where we look and say, man, the struggle is real. Let's identify it. Let's talk about it. Let's recognize it. Let's not act like it's not there. We're pretty good at acting like these struggles aren't there, aren't we? And how much healthier is it to come in and go, hey, this struggle is here. It's been here. It's not new. But to just acknowledge that elephant in the room and say, things are different. There are racial struggles that have been happening. We all don't fully understand all there is to understand. You know how we're ever going to get there? To jump in and have conversations. To choose to say, you know what? We really can do this together, even though everything around us says that we can't. We can. Are there going to be bumpy times? Are there going to be uncomfortable times? Yeah, there will be. So this complaint, the Hellenists, the Hebrews, we got this all about serving widows. Isn't that funny? It surfaces around who's getting served the best. It's just, it's unique. It's bizarre. It's human nature. This is 2,000 years ago. We have the same, we can still get all our feathers ruffled about these same things. So let's take a deep breath and say, you know what? Sometimes we can get our feelings hurt. Sometimes I get my feelings hurt, and I was out of line for my feelings being hurt. But you know what? My feelings still got hurt, even though I misread the situation. I still have to deal with the fact that my feelings got hurt, and sometimes that just has to be acknowledged. So that's kind of what's going on here. We're distributing, we're serving widows and the Hellenists and the Hebrews. The 12 summon the full number of disciples and said, it is not right that we should give up the preaching of the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men who are of good repute, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we will appoint to this duty. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And what they said pleased the whole gathering. And they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip and Prochorus and Nicanor and Timon and Parmenas and Nicolaus, a proselyte of Antioch. And they sat before the apostles and they prayed and they laid their hands on them. And the word of God continued to increase And the number of disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great number of priests became obedient to the faith. And Stephen, full of grace and power, doing great wonders and signs among the people. And then some of those who belonged to the synagogue of the freedmen, as it is called, and the Cyrenians, and of the Alexandrians, and of those from Cilicia and Asia, they rose up and they disputed with Stephen, but they could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit by which he was speaking. Man. I love this highlight that we find of this one guy in this one little section of scripture. He's just a normal guy. He's just one of us. You can tell by just the way the text describes him and why he was actually selected. He wasn't selected because of his great speaking abilities. He wasn't selected because of the impact and influence that he had had in all kinds of places. He was selected because he had a good reputation, because he was a man of wisdom, because he was full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. Let's kind of look at some of these. First, Stephen had lived a life of surrender. He had surrendered his life to the point that there's only one way to be full of the Spirit, and that is if you have surrendered your life. If you have not let your life go, you cannot be full. So he is full of the Spirit because he has surrendered to God. What does it look like today? We know what it looked like then. What does it look like today in Vicksburg, Mississippi, or Jackson, Mississippi? What does it look like to live a life that is full of surrender? What does it look like when we take our hands off and we say, God, you are in control? When we recognize that we have been called on mission with God, and we surrender our lives to that. I had a pastor friend that said this: God can interrupt our lives at any given moment. Any of you ever had those God interruption moments? When God just shook you upside down and changed the trajectory of your life, and you didn't see it coming, and you didn't really know what to do with it, and you said, okay, I'll go. I'll never forget the biggest moment of that when I had to go. I really do believe that God can interrupt my life. I was living in St. Petersburg, Florida. I don't know if you know much about St. Pete. 5 of the nation's top 10 beaches are on that peninsula. If you go 30 minutes the other way, Tampa, Busch Gardens, pay for a day, come back all year. At the time, I had 5 kids. They were in 4th grade and below. Literally, our kids would come home from school, and they would ask this question. I mean, we would ask them this question. Would you like to go to the beach, or would you like to go to ride a roller coaster? And either one that they answered, we could make happen, and we did. We were at the beach on Christmas Eve that year. Isn't that crazy? Especially in light of the weather we've had recently. I didn't get in the water. They played in the water that day. But we're living in childhood paradise, right? Beaches, roller coasters, everything was great. And I'm telling you, God interrupted our lives and said, hey, what about going and planting a church? Okay, man, yeah, let's go somewhere fun, right? We're going to go to San Diego. We're going to go in Florida. We're going to go. He said, no. What about Jackson? And I was like, yeah, no. Right? I got all these fun stuff. And he was like, yeah, what about Jackson? Sometimes God interrupts our lives and calls us to literally pick up our families and move 700 miles, even though it was back home. Sometimes it's a call for us to switch jobs, and it doesn't make sense, and it doesn't line up. Sometimes it's to come be a part of a fellowship that is making a difference in the city. But at any given moment, that moment that you say, I know God's leading me to this, and it doesn't add up, and you step into that, that's a sign of your surrender. That's an image that you have surrendered your life, that you have let it, God, be in control. Really, what's happening in Acts chapter 6 is a disciple-making movement. And honestly, at City Light Church, you're a part of a disciple-making movement. Man, I get so excited when I hear Pastor Brian talk about what God is doing here amongst you. And I love hearing his heart. I don't know if y'all know this, but he's very methodical. Okay. Y'all may not know this about me. I'm not. That's not the way I'm wired. Man, he's an engineer. He thinks like that. Not me, man. I'm a big picture guy. And so I can look at this, and you know what the truth is? God needs all of us. Right? Because, man, if there weren't people that were putting all the blocks in the right order and making sure that the bridge is going to stay all the way across, that's a good thing. But there's also got to be people going, hey, what could be? Where do we need that bridge to go? It takes all kinds of people. And whatever your gifting and your personality and your shape and your molding, God wants to use that right where you are. And he may change that and transform that and alter that. And a part of our call is to say, God, we're surrendered to you. And you have the right to do in my life whatever you want. God, I surrender to you. As I look at Stephen's life, I'm kind of a gutsy guy. I like to be out there on the front end. I like being out there. But man, Stephen's got guts. He steps into this racial strife and says, I'll go. God, what do you want me to do? And so he starts serving, which I think is the next step that God calls us to. He calls us first to surrender, and then he calls us to serve. What are they doing? They're serving the widows. Literally, they are just taking food and providing it for widows. If we really want to live a life that's going to make Jesus do something different, we got to completely surrender to him. But a part of completely surrendering to him is picking up the towel and serving. He modeled that for us. Jesus did. And I love the different instances of when that happened with Jesus. They're so remarkable. Just before he dies, they all walk into the room. You ever thought about what happened as everybody's walking in? As those disciples are walking in? Obviously, because Jesus walks over and picks up the towel and the bowl of water, it's sitting in the corner of the room where it's supposed to be when you come in to wash your feet. What did Peter do when he walked in? Oh, yeah. Somebody needs to serve that. I wonder who's going to do it. Bartholomew walks in and goes, huh, I wonder if I should be the one. Judas walks in and goes, I'll pay somebody to do it. But Jesus walks in and says, I'll do it. And he picks up the towel and he starts washing their feet. And he gets to Peter and Peter says, no way. No way. I'm not letting you do this. You're Jesus. You're the Savior. You're better than this. Get up. That's for servants. You're not a servant. You're a king. What does Jesus say? Unless I wash your feet, you're going to have no part of me. Jesus literally picked up the towel. And he served. I don't know Stephen's whole giftings. The Bible doesn't go into that. I bet, just looking at him, you're looking at his guts and the fact that he's ticked off everybody in the world, that he has some other ability other than to be able to just serve the widows. But he jumped in and he did it. He jumped in and he said, I'm going to willingly serve. We must look for opportunities to serve. We must use the gifts that God has given us. And sometimes it's not even a gift. Sometimes it's just our presence. Sometimes it is just our presence. And we show up willing to say, I'll do whatever it takes. What do you need me to do? I'll do it. And sometimes it's not even waiting for them to respond to that. It's just looking and seeing that the need is there. This has to happen. And I'm going to make it happen. I love the ladies that led worship. I think y'all lead worship every week, or at least you've led every time I was here. Pastor Corey wasn't here today. I love Pastor Corey. As far as I can tell, things went great. That's a sign of good leadership. He wasn't planned on not being here. Got sick, got the flu. Well, some planning. But you jumped in, and as far as I can tell, everything went just like it was supposed to. Jumped in and said, what can I do? What does he normally do? Ah, thank you, sir. I appreciate that. I'm going to go ahead and take a sip right now. What's your name? Robert, can I ask you a question? Somebody asked you to do that? Who asked you to do that? All right. And what'd you do? You went and got it. Did they offer you $100 to do it? No. Did they say, man, I'll take you to lunch? What'd they say? Can you go get some pasture so that the pasture doesn't dry out? And you said, yes, ma'am. How old are you? What grade are you in? Where do you go to school? Say that, what elementary? Warrenton Elementary. What if we could all respond the way Robert did? What if we all just said, okay. How often do we respond with, why can't you do that? Right? If you ever respond that way to her, I want you to know after your mama gets on to you, I'm going to whip you, okay? How often do we look around and go, that's not my job? Wait a minute. If we want to get spiritual, God hasn't called me to do that. Right? What if we just always went, yes, ma'am. I'm going to make that happen. I don't want him to dry out either. I'm going to go get him a bottle of water. Look for opportunities. Man, your staff is led by probably, arguably, the busiest man in the state of Mississippi. Right? I don't know how he does it. I was on a podcast with him Thursday, or I think it was Thursday. He's doing Mission Mississippi. I don't know how he keeps up. I can't keep up with his schedule. Man, look for opportunities to say, Pastor Brown, what can I do? Maybe not even ask him. Maybe just see something that he always does, and you do it just because you know he needs it done. Corey's selling houses all over central Mississippi. What if you looked for ways to serve Pastor Corey and said, what can I do? What if you walked in here and said, man, what needs to be done? Or better yet, what if you looked at this glorious city and said, what needs to happen that's not happening? What if you just built a team and made a difference right here, right now? And said, I can't do everything, but I can do this. I'll tell you, Vicksburg would notice. Vicksburg will that catches eyes. I want you to know, Vicksburg already looks at City Light and says, that's different. It's a different church. It's not like any other church in the city, right? Man, keep looking for opportunities to just make a difference. This, honestly, serving together, what I have found, it's actually a part of our model of ministry. We say we serve the city first. And honestly, as you're in the dream process and you're planning all this out, it's like, yeah, man, we're going to serve all these people. And as we serve these people, we're going to be able to invest our lives in them. In the real reality, do you know what happens? It's the people that you serve with that you start investing your life in. And so it's really just inviting people to serve alongside you. And as you start serving alongside people, I say this all the time. You can go to any restaurant, and there's a long line for women, or go to a sporting event, and there's a long line at the women's bathroom. And you got women there sitting in line, never seen each other before, and they're going, yabba, 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 yabba. They'll tell their whole life story standing in the bathroom line, right? Y'all know that doesn't work for men. Y'all ever seen a line of men sitting somewhere? They go, Packers lost last night. That's about as much as you're going to get out of them. You get six men to go dig a hole. Before you get to the bottom, you can tell every part of every man's story. There's something, the way we're wired, that when we start serving together, we start just naturally opening and letting our life story flow out of us. And as we do that, what you start to realize is if you're paying attention, you'll see connection and relationship that flow out of serving together. So ultimately what happens for Stephen, yep, he's surrendered, he's serving, but all of that opened platforms for him to start sharing Jesus' story. And that's ultimately what's going to lead to his death, is that he uses these serving opportunities to share the story of what Jesus has done. And as he shares his story, we realize that that's where worship happens. It's vitally important in the life of a church to have gatherings like this. Gotta do it. Necessary, it's vital, it's important. It's part of our livelihood, it's a part of who we are, it's a part of what we need. But this isn't the only place that worship occurs. In fact, this is the only place where worship occurs collectively. The rest of the time, we are worshiping everywhere else that we go. And so, literally, Stephen is inviting people into worship in all kinds of places to the point that people that don't worship Jesus say, we're sick of this and we're going to kill him. They say that they come to dispute with Stephen, but they could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which he was speaking. He was so full of the Spirit. He was so surrendered that it just naturally oozed out of him. You gotta like that, don't you? It's a little, it's a perfect sound pound in the back. You can hear it. I love kids. I want y'all to know that. I absolutely love them. And by the way, you have the best welcoming committee that you could ever create. Majesty met me at the front door, and we played games, and she laughed, and she told me stories, and we played I Spy with my little eye, and then we did, she said, let's play Paper, Rock, Scissors, and I said, great. And you know what she did? Woo! That beats them all. I win. I was like, this is great. I love it. Kids are the lifeblood of a church, I believe. So I love hearing kids and seeing them in the back. It's just great. Please celebrate with Majesty. She was awesome. Robert, thanks for my water. What would we do without kids? And we get the opportunity to share our story, his story, with kids. We get the opportunity to share our story, his story, everywhere that we go. What happens in a life like this? We recognize that Stephen is doing some very unique things, but he's just a normal guy. Quote unquote, he is just a church member. Don't y'all like the way we do that? We have these levels. We have pastors, and we have deacons, and we have elders. We have, I'm just a church member. No. That's not at all how the Bible describes any of this. We're all just church members. And it's all our jobs to serve, to share, to talk, to surrender, and to recognize that all of these things are our platforms that God has given us. Whether it's in the school, whether it's in the workplace, whether it's at home. And then he calls all of us to share his story. For Stephen, they've said a life is about 30,000 days. And if you pictured that with $1 bills, we'd have stacks of $1 bills all over this place. Stephen had the chance to put all of his life on this one time and paid $30,000 up front, and they just killed him on the spot. But most of us are spending those one day at a time. One day at a time. How are you spending those 30,000 days? Are you surrendered? Are you serving? Are you sharing his story? Because I don't know about you, but when I get to heaven, I don't want Jesus sitting at the right hand of the Father going, "Whew, man, I just did have enough blood to cover you." Right? I want to get there, and Jesus stands up and goes, "Man, I loved watching your story. I love being a part of what you were doing. Come here. Let me let you meet the Father." That doesn't just go, "Yeah, come on in. Come on in. I was in control. I saw everything in your life." I want him to go, "You're here. Man, I'm glad you're here." I think Stephen closes his eyes. And the next time he's aware of anything, man, he's giving Jesus a high five, and Jesus is saying, "You're the man. I can't believe you're so awesome. Come meet the Father." I want to challenge you to look around, to jump in. There's, like I said, Pastor Brian, Pastor Corey, they brag about y'all all the time. I got to spend six months in that little cohort with them. Y'all are doing these things. Keep on keeping on. Keep on recognizing that you're a part of something here that's big. That you're making an impact in our city, in this city, that matters. Your willingness to sit in uncomfortable space and have uncomfortable conversation literally will change the face and the story of Mississippi. It matters. Keep on being surrendered. Keep on serving. And keep on sharing his story. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you for guys like Stephen that live a life in such a way that make you do something different. I thank you for the challenge that can be to us and to our hearts and to our lives. Lord, I pray that you help us to recognize and to see opportunities that we can have right here, right now, to be your hands and to be your feet. Lord, break our hearts of our pride, so that we can surrender and see what you see. Lord, give us the courage to speak on the platforms that you have given each one of us to share your story. And Lord, allow us to serve you and your kingdom wholeheartedly with all that we are. Lord, I thank you. I thank you. for the 30,000 days that you've given us. Lord, allow us to spend those days well. We ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Do I give the closing announcements? I will. I'll give you all kinds of announcements. We have a meeting today. No, you come up. Let me help you up.
Thank you. Church. Hey. Thank you, Pastor, for that wonderful sermon. All right, so church, stand with us as we worship once again.
All right. Like Pastor Brian always ends our service with the reading of the Great Commission from the end of the book of Matthew. This is Jesus speaking to the disciples after his resurrection. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Church, go and tell someone about your beautiful Savior. Amen.